Hi guys, it's Adam and welcome to another video. So, last summer I did a load of courses, eBay related courses, on a site called Skillshare. And now I've decided to migrate those courses over from that website to YouTube. So there's going to be loads of different beginner courses that are going to be coming over here for you guys to view on this YouTube channel. So with that being said, the next video you're going to see is obviously one of those courses. Hope you enjoy. Welcome to another video class. So in this class, you're going to learn how to do your first ever Amazon FBA shipment. Now, obviously, if you've searched this on Skillshare, I am assuming for the purposes of this course that you have already signed up for an Amazon seller account. And also you'll be somewhat familiar with the Amazon seller platform. Obviously they are sort of requirements for this course because what we're going to be doing is just looking at the specific process of actually doing an Amazon FBA shipment. I'm not going to be walking you through how to create an Amazon seller account or anything like that. So it is kind of a requirement that you have a seller account and that you do know a little bit about the platform, about navigating the platform. However, I am still going to walk you through step by step how to list an item and how to navigate the platform a little bit as well. So if you would like to learn how to do your first ever Amazon FBA shipment, or let's say you might have already done an Amazon FBA shipment a while ago, but you want to refresh your memory on it, then this course is perfect for you. And without further ado, I won't ramble anymore. We'll get straight on with this. So I will see you in a second on the computer screen. Hi guys, so as you can see in this first section, we are actually in the Amazon Seller Central. So obviously this is the page you'll be confronted with when you log in. And what I want you to do is go up here to inventory and go down to add a product. This is the first step in the process. And now you're going to be confronted with this add a product, list a new product, little search bar here. Now this is where an actual barcode scanner comes in really, really handy, because in here you can actually just search a product name. So if, for example, I've got a Lego set here, it's set number 76044. So I could just type in here 76044 and obviously it'll pull it up, and then I can obviously you've got a few options here. Now basically I just go with the one that's got the best sales rank, and a sales rank that is closer to 1 is better. So for example, a sales rank of 100,000 or a sales rank of 10,000, the 10,000 is much better than 100,000, and actually 10,000 is quite a good fast selling toy. It's not the fastest selling toy, but it's pretty, you know, it's pretty decent rank. So obviously you see here there's actually two options. We've got Lego Clash of the Heroes 7644 and we've got Lego 7644 Super Heroes Batman v Superman Clash of the Heroes. They're both the same product. However, what someone's done, one person's created a listing and then another person's created a listing. So what we want to do is actually sell this product on the fastest selling listing, on the most popular listing that actually more customers are buying on. So obviously this top one here, if we look at sales rank, that one's got a sales rank of 6,596 and that one is 406,000. So definitely this one is better to go for. So obviously if you're confronted with multiple options, look at that sales rank, make sure it is closer to 1. But if we just go back, and we go back to this page here. So obviously with a Lego set, it's quite easy. You can just type in the name. However, if you've got like a DVD or something like that, just typing in the name might not pull up the right listing for that item. So obviously you've got a barcode on the back of the product here. So this is where a barcode scanner, you can buy these on eBay or Amazon very, very cheaply. This is where this comes in real handy. You just give it a scan. Sometimes it takes a minute to actually scan, especially with my barcode scanner being quite old. One second, let me turn it round. Might be the fact that it's actually not turned round. Well, unfortunately, my barcode scanner has actually just given up on me after about a year and a half of using this scanner. Actually, it will not scan for some reason. I've been trying for quite a while, but obviously you know the drill. If you get a barcode scanner, it's very easy. You scan it in, and what will actually pop up in here in this search bar is the actual barcode number, and it will automatically search that for you. So obviously, if I just type this barcode number in very quickly for you, then you'll be able to see kind of what it'll pull up when you scan it in with your barcode scanner. So obviously barcode scanners are about sort of £10 to £15 on eBay or on Amazon. So they're quite, you know, they're reasonably cheap. And as you can see, it's pulled up the result there that was 6,000 in toys and games. So the good thing with a barcode scanner is it will actually pick the original listing, the listing that was first set up and that is actually been in the Amazon catalog for longer, and that is normally the best listing to obviously go for. It's not always, but it's usually the best listing to go for. So it'll just scan that in automatically once you scan it. And then what we want to do is click here on the sell yours option. Now, for some products are actually what's known as restricted or gated. So what that means is that you won't be able to sell certain products. However, other products you will be able to sell. So obviously if this button isn't available to you, that is why. So certain products you might not be able to sell. But yeah, certainly I'm just going to click this sell yours here. A new window will pop up and it'll be the product listing page basically. So if you're familiar with the eBay product listing page, it is a little bit different to that. However, it's, in my opinion, it's a lot more streamlined and it's a lot faster to actually list an item. So I'm just going to click here on this advanced view so that then we can see all the different options. Now, you don't actually have to put in half of this information. It is actually really, really easy. So what I do here is at the top first, I open this in a new tab. So I just right click on that and open in a new tab, and this will show you the product listing page. So this is what people can see on Amazon right now. And then what we want to do is go down here to the sort of the mid right hand corner down here, 43 used and new. So we want to click that. And then we want to click Prime because we want to be competing with other Amazon FBA sellers. We don't want to be competing with other merchant fulfilled sellers. As an FBA seller, our only competition should really be those other Amazon FBA sellers. So we're looking at the Prime option here and looking at the lowest Prime. So we can see here we've got £17.28, and then we've got loads of other Prime sellers coming in all the way up to £25. So obviously here, this is where you can price your item quite easily actually. So if you want a quick sale, or if I want a quick sale on this item, I would click in here. Was it £17.28? I think it was £17.28, yeah. So if I wanted a quick sale, I just type in the your price section, £17.28. Now you can put in a seller SKU. This is like an identifier for yourself. So when it sells, obviously that SKU will pop up in the order details. So you could maybe put in there the date you bought it, or you could maybe put in there the price you paid. So for example, I could put like 4/7/18, and then I could put sort of like a little dash, and then I could put £2 or something, and then that will be a unique identifier for you, and it will give you the price of what you paid when you sold it. So that's always quite a nice thing. However, I don't use the SKU field that much because I'm not a quantity seller on Amazon. If you are a quantity seller where you're selling a large amount of items, whether it be unique items or just singular, whether it be unique items or whether it be sort of bulk items, so selling one item in bulk, the seller SKU is really, really good. But as I say, I'm a fairly small-time seller on Amazon, so I don't feel the need to use that section particularly that much. I don't ever fill in the recommended retail price. I don't put a sale price, but you can actually choose to put a sale price, and then you can choose the sale end date and start date, but I don't choose to do that. Then condition. Now, this is arguably, this is the most important part of the actual listing page. So basically, Amazon customers are very, very picky with condition. Now, this set here, there's no scuffs on the boxes. There's no scuff on the box, sorry. There's no dents on the box. It is what I would class on Amazon as a new item. But even if on this item there was the smallest little bit of shelf wear or a little bit of a dint on the box or anything like that, or a little bit of a rip on the side of the box, I would be putting that as either used very good condition or used like new. As it stands, I am going to actually list this as new completely because I feel like this is a new item. However, even if an item is brand new and sealed, but it has a little bit of a rip or it has a little bit of a dent in the box, it might be worth you listing it as used like new or used very good, just bringing that price down a little bit, because obviously Amazon customers are so strict. And if there is, you know, if you have a, let's say you have a cellophane seal on an item, then there's a little rip in the seal, and then someone gets that as a gift, you know, maybe it's a Prime member who bought it on with one day delivery, gets it as a gift for someone else, they see a rip in the seal. It's been, obviously, it's been advertised as new. They're not going to be happy because Amazon customers are a lot more strict than eBay customers. So you will want to make sure you're sort of under-promising condition, but over-delivering. So if your condition, you know, always put your condition one down from where you think it is, or at least in line with where you think it is. Never try and grade over. So if you think something's like new, never ever put it as new. Always put it as like new or used very good. Similarly, if you think something's used very good condition, maybe put it as used good just to cover yourself, because a negative feedback on Amazon can have quite a lot more impact on your account and your account health than a negative feedback on eBay can. So just remember that condition is very important. And obviously here I've specified the condition is new, but let's say I did want to put this as used good, then the condition note field will be freed up and I can actually type in here in good used condition. So I can just type in good used condition, and then I always put on the end picked and packed by Amazon, because some people, some customers don't realize what Amazon FBA is, and they feel that they're buying completely from a third party seller. So this gives them a little bit of confidence that actually, yes, they are buying from a third party seller in myself. However, they know now that Amazon are going to be doing the picking and the packing of the order and the shipping out. So it gives them a little bit more confidence if they see that in obviously the ability of Amazon getting the product safely to themselves, opposed to someone, you know, a third party doing the same thing. So you can do that, but obviously when you select a condition as new, just completely new, it actually blanks out the condition note, so you can't actually put a condition note. So it is even more important to, if you are describing an item as new, it does really need to be in perfect condition, because you don't have that option to elaborate in that condition note. Amazon don't give you that option. Handling time, we don't need, because Amazon are going to be sorting the handling time. Restock date, I don't ever put that, but obviously you can put a restock date, and then that, I believe that'll notify you that you will want to reset, restock your item. Product tax code, I've never used that. Enter a product tax code from the list supplied to you. I imagine that's maybe more if you're VAT. I'm not 100% sure, but I've never used that. Can be gift messaged. Is gift wrapped available? I've never ticked those because I believe Amazon actually handle that. So I've never actually ticked those. Max order quantity, again, I've never ticked that. I just leave that blank. Offering a release date, again, I've not ticked that either. Now, here's the next important thing. You want, so I want to dispatch this item myself to the customer if it sells. That is what's known as Amazon Merchant Fulfilled. So if you select that option, you will have to, the merchant, which is yourself, will have to fulfill the order yourself, basically. So what will happen when it sells is you will have to pick it and pack it, and obviously store it. But this is the option we want to choose for if we are doing it with Amazon FBA. So this bottom option, I want Amazon to dispatch and provide customer service for my items if they sell. So obviously that is the option you want to choose for Amazon FBA. And then we're just going to save and finish the listing. It is as simple as that. Obviously, You might want to price higher. So for example, I've gone for £17.28, which is the lowest price. So that means I'm going to get a quick sale of a price at that. But on second thoughts, I might go maybe £17.99. And you don't have to necessarily compete as being the bottom price. Obviously, you can choose your price depending on how long you want to wait for a sale, essentially. So I think I'm just going to go up just a little bit by $17.99. I'm not going to be the cheapest price FBA offer there, but that's okay. I'll just wait a little bit. So obviously $17.99 there. And also there is the option to match the lowest price there. So you can just click that button and it'll fill it in for you, but I'm not going to do that, as I say, because I'm going for $17.99. So we're just going to click save and finish, and we're almost done the actual listing process, the actual process of listing something. Now what we will get pulled up is basically this little thing here. So we just want to select, one second, I'll just have to read through this very quickly. Within your seller account, apply them yourself, use manufacturers. You want to select here, you want to select here Amazon barcode, and I'll go through what that means later on in the process when we go through the labeling up part of this process. This is actually a new page that I've never seen before, so I did have to quickly, obviously read through it, but I know exactly what this is talking about, and I will actually elaborate on this later on. So just select Amazon barcode and then click save and continue. And then, obviously, dangerous goods will come up. So if you've got, I believe it's if you've got batteries or, you know, perfumes and things like that, you have to click on this add dangerous goods information. And this isn't, obviously here, battery information. Is this product a battery or does it utilize batteries? No, it doesn't. Product regulation, is this product considered to be a dangerous good or hazardous material for transport, storage or waste? No, it isn't. And obviously, you just select the required fields, really, the correct fields. And then obviously you need to ensure that your selections are correct, and then submit, because you might get yourself into trouble if you select no when it actually is a hazardous material. So then that's complete, that information is complete. You just want to click save and continue. And then we're going to come into the process that we are actually starting a new Amazon FBA shipment. So this will get pull up a new Amazon FBA shipment that you're going to compile over time with all the different products that you're going to be listing. And obviously, you will enter the quantity of the items down here. So I believe I've got one of these, but I will just double check off camera as well. But I'm just going to type in one there. And as you can see, that new listing has come up in this new shipment. And obviously, you can build the shipment and build the shipment and build the shipment. So obviously, what I'm going to do now is, because I've got quite a few items to actually enter in, I'm going to enter in the rest of my items off camera. If you need any more help with that listing process, I would advise you just to go back in this course and just re-watch the process of me listing that one item, and then you can obviously pick up on things you might have missed out on in the first time of watching it. But yeah, so I'm going to enter in all the other items, and then I'll come back to you, and what you'll actually see is this list will be longer, will be larger, and will be more full of items. So I will see you in a little bit, guys. Right then, guys, you join me just after I am listing my last item, or just at the process of finishing listing my last item. I'm just adding the information here. So obviously it doesn't contain a battery and it's not dangerous. So I'm just going to submit this. The reason I wanted to show you this is because when I click save and continue, there's a screen that comes up that didn't come up before. So there's this screen here. Now, this is because I've already created a shipping plan. So what you want to do when you get to this page after you've listed your second item is you want to click here to add to an existing shipping plan, because you've already created a shipping plan with that first listing, and then choose the necessary one. Sometimes there'll only be one option, so that's fine, but if there's more than one option, check the date and time here and then choose the option that is obviously the one that's closest to the date in which you're doing the shipment. So yeah, basically choose the correct shipping plan and then click add to shipping plan and continue. And then obviously you can see here I've listed a bunch of items, loads of different items on here. It's the same process to list all these items, hence why I didn't go through the listing process for all the individual items, because as I say, it is the same process. I have actually got two of these, so I'm going to input two in the quantity field here. Now obviously in this quantity field you can see I've got some of five, some of two, some of one. All you need to do in that field is just click the amount of quantity you've got. So if you've got 10, then you enter 10. If you've got one, you enter one, etc, etc. So now what we're going to do is I've listed all the items. It's only a very small shipment of 23 items, and I'm just going to click continue down here. So I don't know whether you saw that actually, because obviously my webcam might be blocking that, but basically right at the bottom of the page there's a little continue button. I'm not sure whether you're going to be able to see that or not, but there is just a little sort of yellowy sort of blue continue button, and you just press that, quite easy. And then what we want to do is who prepares, apply to all. I want to prepare my items, so I'm preparing them. And if you go into this tab up here, so this is like your prepping section now. So if you go into this prep required, it will tell you what items will come up here are the ones that need actual prep. So for example, if you've got a games console, you might need to bubble wrap that games console. So it'll show up here, the unit, so it'll show up the actual sort of listing, as it would on the previous page, and then it'll say prep required, and then it'll just say bubble wrap or something like that. So what you need to do in this prep field is come into here to prep required, or maybe it's preparation may be required. It's prep required, and then it'll give you a list of all the items that you need to prep. So this is quite important, because obviously you need to remember to come in here to prep your items correctly, to get the information to prep your items correctly, so then you can obviously do that, ship them out, and then Amazon are going to be able to process them in the best way. If you do not prep them, you might get a little bit of a nasty email from Amazon saying you've not prepped this correctly or whatever. So I've never actually had an email like that, because I've always prepped my items correctly, and I always do mainly new items anyway, which don't need any prep in most circumstances. But I am assuming that you will get some sort of email off Amazon telling you you shouldn't be doing that, you need to be prepping your items correctly. So I'm just going back to all products, and as I say, I'm just applying the seller to all these. And again, I'm just going to this far tab here, prep preparation may be required, and just putting seller in there just to apply that to all of them. So I think I just click, do I click apply to all? No, I don't need to click that. Don't worry about that. I just need to click the seller tab there. So now what we can do, once you've done any prep that needs to be required, if you've got all new items like I have, you won't really need to prep them, so that's cool. So then again, you just want to go down here to this bottom right hand corner to the continue button. And then now we will come to labeling. So basically what you need for labeling, well, what I have, again, I'm just clicking who labels, and then I'm just putting seller. So basically, do you remember that page that we came across that said who, what sort of labels are you using? Are you using manufacturers, or are you using Amazon barcodes? Well, basically, if you choose the Amazon barcode option, then you have to label up all your products with a unique Amazon barcode, that then when your items get to the shipping center, Amazon will scan them into their system using their barcode. If you go down the route of just sending all your items in with the manufacturer's barcode, so just like the original barcode on the bottom, basically Amazon will charge you, I believe it's 20 pence per item, for the privilege of them actually entering it into their system with their new label. So basically, if you do the prep beforehand in your work area or wherever, and label them up properly with the Amazon barcodes, you will get out of paying 20 pence a listing, obviously, or an item even. So basically, I've got 23 items in this shipment. I'd be paying, you know, £4 or £5 or whatever to get them labeled up. Now, in some circumstances, between time and money, sometimes it's good just to pay that extra and obviously, miss out on a little bit of time spent doing that, which is good, obviously, because you can get on with other things. But obviously, I want to spend save money wherever I can, being a small business, so I just do it myself. So what you'll need is any one of these different labels per page. So you can go on to eBay, and I would recommend the 27 labels per page. If you go onto eBay and type in 27 labels per page, something should come up. I'll try and put like an image on screen of what you're kind of looking for. But yeah, 27 labels per page. And this is basically where a label sheet is split into 27. So if I go print labels for this page now, something will come up down here, a little download. And if I click that, it'll give me 27 different labels on one page. And the barcode labels that you will buy will be 27 per page. So it fits nicely. And you can just peel them off nice and easily. Unfortunately, I've actually run out of those sheets. I've just run out a couple of weeks ago. So I can't show you them in person right now of what I mean by what they are. What I'm using at the moment is I'm just using a one per page sheet of labels and then just cutting them out basically, which isn't very efficient. So definitely, I would definitely recommend getting the actual 27 per page. And let's say you just come down here to print labels after you've selected that the seller is gonna label them. Click on that little download link there and it'll pop up in a new tab to print them out, and then you'll print the labels out, and then I will just, once I've shown you the labels in a second, I'll be right back. And I will show you the labelling up process on a couple of different items, because there is a specific way you need to go about it. And then it's basically just sort of getting things in the box and getting the boxes labelled up, you know, putting void fill in the box. So it's quite easy after that. So it's not too much of a hard process. The listing is the bit that takes a while, because, and the labelling up can take a while, because obviously you have to, it's quite tedious, it's quite repetitive. You have to list, you know, list all your items until you've got your shipment built up, and then you have to label each individual item, which isn't necessarily a hard thing to do, it's just quite repetitive and takes a little bit of time. So I'll be right back in a second with how you can label up your items properly. Right then, guys, so I'm just going to add this labeling up process onto the last section, and then we're going to go on to actually labeling up your box, all that sort of stuff, getting items in the box, all that sort of stuff that obviously needs a little bit of care and attention. But yeah, so basically I've got my one of my items here. It's brand new and sealed Doctor Who the Key to Time box set, and as you can see, we've got the manufacturer's barcode on the bottom there. Now Amazon don't like it when, or don't recommend, you basically put their barcode, which is this barcode here that I've printed out. I don't think the light's capturing that very well. But they don't like it if you were to put it anywhere else but on the actual manufacturer's barcode, because if they scan in the manufacturer's barcode, that's no good to them. They need to scan in this barcode. So you have to put their barcode directly over the manufacturer's barcode. I don't know how well you can see that. So their barcode is directly over the manufacturer's barcode, so they cannot scan the manufacturer's barcode. They can only scan their Amazon barcode. So please do make sure that when you're labeling up, all of your labels, your Amazon labels, are going over the manufacturer's barcode. So I'm just gonna do that with one more item as well here. So I actually have two of these. So again, I'm just gonna do it with this one. So I'll check where, I don't know where my, there it is. So there's my little barcode for this one. Basically what I do is lay out all my barcodes in front of me, and then I can just choose, I can get them up on the table, choose which one I'm going to do with the barcode, and then stick it on. Now you've also got to be careful, obviously. A beginner mistake, a rookie mistake that I've made is putting the wrong labels on the wrong items. What that will do, if that happens, is it will go into the Amazon Problem Solving Center, and it may take longer to process your shipment, and also you might get a little slap on the wrist as well from Amazon for not labeling your items in the correct way. So it's always good just to double check your items once you've labeled them all up, right, are they all on the correct ones, before you end up boxing them up, closing the box up, and then putting the box labels on and shipping it out. So anyway, so what I'm going to do is, again, just obviously All I've done is basically cut these labels off the one per page. However, you won't need to do that because they'll all be on a ready cut out page of 27 labels. So yeah, I'm just gonna again just put this over the manufacturer's barcode. Make sure that it's completely over the barcode as well. So there's none of the manufacturer's barcode left to actually scan. It's completely over there and it's nicely firm on. So yeah, and don't put any sellotape or anything over that barcode to hold it on. Don't do that. That's why we use the actual sticky labels, because obviously Amazon do not like any sellotape over any of the barcodes on any of the products or even on the box. So that's something you've got to be aware of as well. So I'll leave this segment here, guys. We'll now get on to actually finishing up, putting the items in the box, that sort of stuff. Going through the process of actually labeling up the box, all that sort of stuff. Very, very easy sort of wrapping things up. And then after that, I'm just going to tell you a little bit about how you can actually send your shipment out, because that might be one that people don't really know how to do. You know, they might be thinking, right, I've got this box labeled up, but how do I send it? So that's something I'm going to talk about as well. So I'll see you in the next segment, guys. So guys, we've now done the labelling up and it is just onto sort of boxing things up and then entering in the weight dimensions into Amazon and then completing the shipment, putting the box labels onto the parcel, and that's about it really. And also I will, as I promised, I will go through and tell you how to actually drop your items off at a UPS shop, or how you can actually send your box out, because I know some people might not know how to do that. So basically I use double walled cardboard boxes. I've got mine down there, but it is full of all the items that I've just listed, so I won't pick it up right now. But it's a double walled cardboard box. I'll try and put a screenshot in one of the corners. And the reason I use a double walled box is just that level of protection. You can buy these off eBay and Amazon. You can scavenge for these in sort of supermarkets, places like that. But I would recommend you buy new ones, fresh ones online, because they're a bit stronger, a little bit sturdier. You can get them for about £1 a box, so it's not too much of an expense. And also I wanted to talk about, obviously, packaging material. So Amazon do not like you using what's known as, obviously, packing peanuts, or sort of those little, I don't know what else you call them, sort of those little styrofoam peanut things anyway. Amazon do not like them, so please do not use them. You will, again, get a nasty email from Amazon saying, you know, why have you used these, when it's obviously within our terms of service that you don't use these in an Amazon FBA shipment. So what I use is, and I've got loads of it here ready to actually fill my box up and prep it. I've got loads of this big bubble wrap. Obviously, again, you can get this on eBay and Amazon, generally about £10 for sort of a 50 meter or 100 meter roll, depending on where you go. Some rolls are more expensive depending on, you know, who's selling it basically, but you can get it as cheap as 100 meters for obviously £10, so that's really, really good. Anyway, so I've got that, and the other thing I like to use is just long strips of newspaper. Now, newspaper is allowed at Amazon, but they don't like little tiny bits being cut off. They like long, thin strips. So please do remember when you're packaging up your box to use long, thin strips. So basically now I've talked a little bit about packaging materials and stuff, what I would like you to do now, before we go onto the next screen, is actually put a layer of bubble wrap in the bottom of your box or something similar, but as I say, not packing peanuts or anything like that. So a layer of bubble wrap in the bottom of your box, fill your box up with your items, and then put a nice thick layer of void fill or dunnage in the form of bubble wrap and newspaper on the top. Fold it in and obviously tape your box up. I have a tape gun down there, which is nice and easy in just taping it up. Make sure that you tape it up nicely at the top and indeed the bottom, because you don't want it, you know, you don't want the bottom caving in, you don't want the top opening up. So obviously make sure you're taping it up really, really nicely, and then obviously holding down the tape a little bit for a second so that then it's nicely in place and it's not going to come off or anything like that. So that's what I'd like you to do before we get on to then obviously our sealed box. We'll need to measure it and weigh it, and we're going to do that right now on the screen. So that'll do it for this segment, and I will see you in the next segment on the screen. So then guys, we are here on the labelling up page and now it is time to press the continue button and continue on with the process. So now it's just reviewing the shipment and it is validating the shipping plan, and you can now here view your shipment contents and you can go through them and review that everything's okay if you'd like to do that. However, I normally do that on the previous page just to speed this process along a bit. So now you can see where it's being shipped to. So it's actually being shipped to the Tilbury shipping centre. Now obviously if you're in the US or you're in a different part of the UK, that shipping centre will be different, but again that's where you can see it, and you can see that all of the items are going to the Tilbury shipping centre. Now it is important to note that if you have oversized items, it might be worth not packing up your box before this process, before you just validate your shipping plan, because sometimes, doesn't happen to me often, but sometimes basically they will want you to send the oversized items to another shipping centre, and if you've just packed up your box, you'll have to unpack it again to get those items out of it to pack them into another box. Now, what do I mean by oversized items? I mean anything that is a larger item that Amazon classes as oversized, and you can find out that information on the Amazon help sheet. If you just type in Amazon FBA FAQ, something like that in Google, I'm sure you'll be able to find that information. So if you do have any larger items, might be worth just keeping them to the side before you obviously pack up your parcel, until you've got to this page here and you know that all your items are going to the same centre. If obviously some are going to a different centre or need to go to a different centre, you will need to pack those items up in a separate box and then put the separate shipping label on, and that will then go off to a different centre and get processed there. The reason they do this is generally just because they like to separate the inventory, so they'll have maybe have one warehouse with more oversized items in and another warehouse with more normal sized items in or smaller items in. So yeah, I'm going to approve that, so all my items are going to the same shipping center, so that's good. So you just want to click approve shipment, and this might take a minute and it'll just validate the shipping plan. If you've got a large shipment of 100 items or so or more, then it might take quite a while. Then you just come to this page, you just want to click work on shipment. Then you'll come to this page, which is the basically the reviewing your shipment contents, that sort of page, choosing your delivery, all that sort of stuff. So basically what you need to do on this page is, you can see here, you can review your shipment by clicking this button here, and then you can choose your delivery service. So ours is going to be a small parcel delivery. As long as you're not shipping a pallet. If you're shipping a pallet, then you do need to actually click this I'm shipping pallets button here. And we're going to go with the Amazon partnered courier, because that will give us a cheaper delivery cost. So then obviously you can see down here, I've selected everything in one box. So if you have more than one box, just simply select this, obviously this one here, more than one SKU per box, total 15 boxes or less. And it's a very, very similar process to go about doing that. But today I'm just selecting everything in one box. And if you do more than one box, basically it'll give you the option to set how many number of boxes you've got. So then if you've got five boxes, you set the number of five boxes and you enter in the individual weight for each of those five boxes and the individual dimensions as well. But as you can see, I've just gone with everything in one box. Over here in this corner, I've put the box weight, which is 5.6 kilos, and then the dimensions here. So obviously you can see these are all the items that I've got in the shipment and that I've packed in the box. And you can review those as well, just to make sure you have packed them in there. And then you can see the weight and all the dimensions this side. Now it is important to note that you're gonna get charged with Amazon per 15 kilos. So for example, if you have a box like I have here of 5.6 kilos, really it might have been worth me waiting to do a shipment until I have a few more items that I could get in the box, because obviously I'm not making use of that 15 kilos. So what I mean is, if you have a box that's 14.5 kilos, or whether you have a box like I have here that's only 5.6 kilos, you're still going to get charged the same amount of money to ship that box to Amazon. So it's always worth trying to fill up your box, have a nice big box, and fill it up the best you can to make use of that, the money that you're paying. So Then you want to go down here to click confirm once you've done your box dimensions and weight. And then obviously you just want to calculate your delivery cost down here. Should be about £5 odd, I believe, unless they've changed it, but I don't think they have. £5.08, yeah. And you see number of boxes 1. This is going to be shipped with UPS, so United Parcel Services. You just want to click over in the left-hand corner, this agree to the terms and conditions, and then accept the charges. You can void the charges within a 24-hour period. You can see here, you have 23 hours, 59 minutes left if you wish to void charges. And then you can just go ahead down here in the left-hand corner and print the box labels. So when you're printing, so they'll come up down here and you just click on them and print them. Now, when you are attaching them to your box, what you need to do is make sure that they are on either side of the seam. So you'll get, what you'll get is you'll print off two labels. You'll print off a UPS label and you'll print off an Amazon FBA label. One is for UPS to scan in and to track the delivery. The other one is for when it gets to the warehouse for Amazon to scan in to actually identify that that's your box. Both of those labels need to be either side of the box seam because Amazon doesn't like you putting the label over the box seam, because if one of their employees actually cuts down the box seam, they will cut through your label, and they don't particularly like labels going over that box seam. So basically cut your two labels apart from each other and put them either side of the box seam. That's an important tip there as well. And don't put any tape over the labels, just stick them on really, really firmly with your hand using the adhesive that's on the label. Don't stick tape over the labels or over the barcodes, because again, Amazon do not like that. So I'm just going to go ahead and print these labels, get them on my box. You can do the same as well. And then I'm just going to go through a final little process of actually dropping your shipment off with, you know, at a UPS store, and actually how to find a UPS store for you to be able to actually drop off your boxes. And that is it. That is the complete shipment. So literally down here, you just click the complete shipment button. I'm not going to do it quite yet because, as I say, I've just got to print these box labels off. But you just press this complete shipment. I'll do that in the next segment, and obviously then we'll go and look at how you can drop it off. So I'll leave it there for this segment, guys, and I will see you in the final part. Right then, guys, so we're on the same page. I have literally just clicked this button down here that did actually just say continue. However, now it says track shipment. So if I just click that, your button down here will say continue. But if I just click that, you can see that I've got the tracking information up here now. And this is the same screen that you will come to once you've clicked that continue button. So you can see here, it's the status is shipped. Don't worry, you don't have to like ship it within the next 2 minutes or anything. It just says that the shipment is going to be shipped or going to be on the way very soon. Now, obviously, you do want to drop this box off as quickly as you can. But as I say, it doesn't have to be immediately. You can wait a couple of days if you need to wait before you ship it. But obviously, Amazon are expecting this shipment now, so it's worth your while to get it shipped out as quickly as possible. I don't know whether there is a deadline on the actual label, on whether maybe it's 3 days or something until the label expires. But obviously, you've printed off your label, you want to get it shipped out within the next couple of days. So what I've done is just typed in UPS drop off near me. Just type that into Google, and it will pull up on Google Maps actually all the different UPS locations that are near yourself. So obviously we've got 3 or 4 locations here, and you can just select more locations, and it will give you the address and obviously where it's located, and the information you need on Google Maps. So it is really as simple as that. You don't need to pay anything when you get to the drop-off point. You literally just need to hand it over. They'll scan it. You might get a receipt, you might not. Some places do, some places don't give out receipts. But you just hand it over, and then they'll take care of the rest. It's now scanned into the UPS system, and it's on its way. So it really is as simple as that. Just obviously, you're looking specifically for a UPS drop-off point, not any other courier service. UPS drop-off point. They're sometimes called access points as well, as you can see here. So there's plenty to choose from near me. So obviously I've got a nice little choice of where I drop this shipment off, and obviously these will change depending on your location. You might have to drive a little bit further, but obviously they're there as well. So it's nice and easy to drop it off. It's not too much hassle. And normally there are quite a lot of these access points up and down the country. So I'm going to leave it there, guys. Thank you very much for joining me on this course. I'm really hoping that you will have got quite a lot of information out of this course and that you can now go on and do your own FBA shipment. So I will leave it there, guys. Thank you very much. As I mentioned, do leave a positive review if you did enjoy it and if you got value out of this course. And I will see you in the next one. So I'll see you very soon, guys.